talk to you officially as part of your curriculum. It will not be the last, unfortunately. There will be a few others that follow me after this over your career, but they're all going to be amazing. So I just wanted to take the opportunity to welcome you to U of T Engineering. And one of the things I really love about engineering here at U of T is the community. We really are a community. It's not just me saying that because I'm trying to get you excited about things, although that is true too. We're a really community here. We make friends. These are friends that help you through the hard times, help you through the good times, help you enjoy the good times. So do look around, find people that you connect with, and partner with them to take this journey on together. So I picked this image here. This is a rainbow hard hat for our engineering positive space group. And my five-year-old son asked me one time, I had this on my backpack, and he asked me, what does that mean? And so it's like, for those of you who are Redditors, this is like a real life app that explained to me like I'm a five-year-old. I said, this symbolizes that anybody who wants to can become an engineer. It's hard work, I'm not gonna lie to you. It's fun though, and anybody who wants to be here can be here, chooses to be here. And that's what the rainbow hard hat symbolizes for me, so I'm happy to have you here. So a little bit about myself. My name is Jason Bazylak, Professor Jason Bazylak. You will, all of you except for the EngSci students will see me very soon, as in tomorrow, in ESB lecture. So I run the first year design course for the Core 8, so I'm gonna be in that. I also identify as a Métis engineer. For those of you who are not familiar, Métis are one of the three indigenous groups here in Canada. And so that has formed a lot of what I do in my path. So early on when I was in your seat, here in engineering, not here, but in where I went to engineering, I was second in my whole family to get a university degree, and I was definitely the first to get an engineering degree. I didn't even know an engineer when I was at your age. So I really felt out of place. Particularly as an indigenous person, I felt like I didn't see anybody else around like me. And so at that point, I kind of internalized this a little bit and I mulled it over, and that led to my passion. My passion is what I followed through right here. So I've taken that passion for seeing that we build more bridges between indigenous communities and the engineering profession, and I used my engineering knowledge to build that passion into a career, and that's what I do now. As well as teach first year engineering. So, so I'm going to start off with a traditional land acknowledgement. The land on which the University of Toronto operates for thousands of years, it has been a traditional land of the Huron Wendat, the Seneca, and most recently the Mississaugas and the Credit River. Today is the meeting place, this meeting place is still home to many Indigenous people from across Turtle Island, and we are grateful to have the opportunity to work on this land. And I think it's pretty telling that this has been a meeting place for thousands, 15,000 plus years, thousands of years, because it is still a really big meeting place. If you look around at your peers right now, every year I do a little bit of a survey, and usually it comes out to the ESB class speaks about 48 different languages, I think was the last time I looked at the numbers. We are from all over the place. We are a wealth of diversity, and we bring that to bear and to do some excellent design work. Okay. I think this picture for me is pretty simple. This is the actual student's engineering jacket. The infinity sign up there, that's the flag of the Métis Nation. And so me, this jacket symbolizes that connection that I'm trying to help build between Indigenous people and engineering. So I talked a little bit about my passion and in the Indigenous community. Now, my question to you is a rhetorical question, don't have to shout it out. What is your passion? What passion drives you? Passions, probably. Knowing how awesome you are as students, there's probably more than one that drives you. And figure out what that passion is that drives you. And think about how you can use that passion coupled with what you're going to take away from an excellent engineering education. How can that passion get you somewhere? What's the journey that's going to bring you to that? So are you going to, you know, use that passion to circle the earth? Are you going to hold the highest office in Canada? Are you going to use it to build fighter jets, fighter planes? Are you going to use it to make sure everybody who's at the workplace comes home safe to their families? Are you going to use it to design better? Are you going to say, you know what? Products should fit people. You don't have to make the people fit the products. Are you going to be an international chess master? Play chess all around the world. Are you going to be an inventor, come up with new and innovative things that radically change things and potentially change society? Are you going to just make a whole ton of money, not that you can eventually make movies and earn Oscars? So my question to you, think about what passion drives you. What is the passion that underlies what you do? Engineering here at UNT is your car, is your vehicle, okay? So I'm actually very jealous of you right now. You're at a spot that, you know, I understand you're stressed right now already, and there'll be more stress to come, but I'm jealous of you because you are at a point in your careers where you have infinite possibilities ahead of you. You got this vehicle that is UNT engineering education, you've got these passions, and all you gotta do is kind of grab that vehicle to where you wanna go. What is the destination you wanna get to? And don't get me wrong, you don't have to have this all figured out. I sure as heck didn't have it all figured out when I was at your age. But I want you to take this journey. Start the journey, go around, find things that motivate you. Go to the class fairs yesterday, all these kind of things. And find things inside engineering and outside engineering that drive you. And I hope that you're gonna have a great time here. And I love being an instructor in engineering because I get to live vicariously through you. I get to see the incredible, amazing things that you are going to do, okay? Without having to take final exams. So, you know, But, all right, well, I want to say thank you very much, and I look forward to seeing you in class tomorrow. And I think next I'll call out on our vice president.
Yes. faculty member of the Department of Applied Chemistry or Chemical Engineering of Applied Chemistry. Also, he's connected to the Department of Biochemistry and the Institute of Biomaterials and Biomedical Engineering. He is a principal investigator also with the Donnelly Center for Cellular and Biomolecular Research at the University of Toronto. He served as the chair of the Institute of Biomaterials and Biomedical Engineering for 5 years prior to his joining the provost office of the vice president's office. And he has this amazing ability to connect the various components of this institution together. And through his work as chair of that institute, bringing health sciences and engineering together, no small feat, and he worked really hard to set up structures within that institute so that it would support your experience and your opportunity to also connect with the health sciences and health profession as you journey through your own experience. He's also a graduate, so he received his bachelor's in chemical engineering and applied chemistry in 1988 and his PhD in chemical engineering from the University of Minnesota in 1996. We're glad that he decided to come back in 1997 and join our faculty again and become a full professor in 2007. So please join me in welcoming Professor Yip to the stage.
Thanks, Micah. Welcome to the class of 2G3. One of the things I did this morning, I went into my basement and I found my jacket. From the class of 88. And I think one of the more interesting facts is that it still fits. So, I'm not sure if you're wrong. It's going to get kind of warm on the jacket all morning. But thank you, Jason, for your opening. Thank you, Michael, for the welcome. As was mentioned, I spent the last 2 years seriously traveling a lot. I've never hit that level status where people on the plane are like, "Hi, good to see you again. Didn't see you 3 weeks ago on the same flight to Japan." So what was interesting is actually, as was mentioned, I spent a lot of time helping to bring international in. And the first thing I asked the comms folks to do, and I think they went to the registrar's office and said, "Can we get this information?" Was how's the diversity of our class? It looks awesome. But I said, "Well, you know, not just the gender diversity and math diversity, but what's the national diversity of our class?" Because I was looking back to what it was like in 1984 when I came in. I didn't think it was as international, very drawn from Toronto, right? And so I asked them, I said, "You know, can you pull up some specs or some data for me?" And I asked them to pull all the national flags. So this is actually the first test for students in this class. We'll give you the flag and then you figure out what country it is. So this represents every country for which there is a first year student. It's super impressive. If you recognize your flag, I want you to share it. Over 50, I think it's 59 or 55 different countries we draw from. And that's incredible. University of Toronto is such a diverse, and we've got such a great cross-cultural, cross-national, international community. This is what makes it such an important and impressive place to be. And one where I want to help you build your international network and build your class and build your friends. The main driver for this, I think it's actually is the fact that Toronto is considered the world's most diverse city. When I started my job in international, I got this deck, and they said, you know, I was like, "Wow, that's impressive. That 180 languages spoken in Toronto, 2 years ago, it was only 140. Right? It continues to increase because we're such a huge draw for the world right now, just reflecting the diversity of culture. So I was asked to kind of give a plenary lecture, a little bit on sort of how I got to where I was and the opportunities and how I ended up doing different things. And I was thinking about this last night because I am a faculty member and I'm used to this whole idea of kind of leaving everything to the very end. You guys are getting very used to this fact, I give deadlines to my faculty, the deadlines to staff. Staff are very good at hitting deadlines. Like, for in general, people are like, yeah, we're good. But I ask faculty for stuff, it's like, yeah, we're gonna do it. I'm actually asking folks for stuff that's currently, like, they're like 6 months late, and I'm not quite sure how many marks I deduct for that. But I wanted to kind of throw up a couple of things that sort of motivated me to put the slide back together last night. And this was the first one. And aside from the other things, what am I showing you here? I'm showing you three different keys. And it almost feels like the evolution of keys in the sense we want to kind of use in engineering and a lot. I've got a standard Medeco key, right? I've got a swipe key, and I've now got this new fog key, right? Showing kind of evolution of technology. But I actually want to use a different context. Each of those keys opens a different door for me in my life right now. One key, kind of the fog key there, the depot key, kind of show how old school they are, the dean's office. That's the key to my office. So it's the key to engineering, right? The key to this faculty, the key what's the driver of this faculty. So I use that to open the door to get into. And so that's kind of my ministry home and my how I drive faculty and get insight from you and learn about what you're interested in doing, what my faculty are interested in, staff are doing, and how we can move this faculty forward, how we can move the university forward, actually. That's what's much more important. The blue one, well, that's my other learning opportunity. Actually, it's kind of sneaky. It's actually a fog that opens a lot of different doors. It's kind of like this Uber fog. But the most important door for me is it actually opens my lab door. It opens the door to my research lab, where I'm going to go in, and I want to hide from deadlines, I want to hide from paperwork, I want to hide from statistics, I really want to hide from budget discussions. When I go to the lab, I mentioned this to the chems yesterday, when I go to the lab, I want to have fun. I want to talk to my students, I want to hear from all my students, I want to hear from my undergrads, the first years who come into my lab for the summer opportunity, I want to hear grad students who come from abroad, I want to hear from the students that have brought in my exchange, I want to hear from my postdocs, and I want to hear from the rest of them. What are they doing? How can I help them? What are their cool ideas? And how can I engage in those ideas? Right? We talk about faculty being researchers, so my students do a test on this, right? Don't let him hear anything, because he's going to break it. He doesn't quite know what he's doing when he gets in the lab. He's going to throw a switch, laser's going to go on, someone's going to get tapped, it's not going to be pretty. Right? But I'm there to help the students because you, students are the ones with the ideas. As faculty, we come up with big, grandiose ideas for what we do. We're the implementers. And a good faculty member takes your ideas. I do this all the time. I take them in a good context. In fact, I take them in a bad context. I take your ideas and say, okay, let's figure out how we can roll this forward. And that's what I want to hear from you as well, as first years for the next 4 years. Just take your ideas and how can I roll them up into projects and plans that help move everything forward to the engineer. So that's kind of my learning. The bigger one is, you know, this is John Wallace's daycare. So I'm kind of like Jason. I have a 7-year-old and a 5-year-old, right? So I'm really in the weeds with this sort of everything kind of, it's like scary thing. I'm getting questions of like, what's thunder? Why does thunder come after lightning? And you're trying to explain to a 5-year-old, like, well, it's like photons and sound waves and air pressure. And they're like, no, it's just scary. Okay, so and then I do that little tricky stuff where you see the light and you count, and then before you hear thunder, you figure out how long it is, before how far away it's on. And so yeah, but those two are like right after each other. Okay, the lightning is like a couple blocks away. So, but the key there is I love watching them learn, right? You see your son or your daughter go in there and they're learning, right? Every day is a different day. And it's that excitement of seeing how they're doing that. And it's even bigger, it's pretty energizing to me after a day of discussing budgets and other stuff like that. So it's all about these learning opportunities and taking these keys and opening those doors and taking advantage of the opportunities that are for your kids going to school, for me to go into my lab, for me to unlock my doors in my offices, and learn from folks who are coming into my office and talk about stuff. I'm sure one of my close to the side. mention this now, Micah heard me say this before. One of the things I want to do, this is going to be a huge shock to the staff. One of the things I want to do is I would love to have coffee with every single undergraduate who's here, and the ones who aren't here, okay, I'll get there as well. Over the course, not tomorrow, okay, not next week, sometime over the next 4 years, right, call on the marker, I want to meet you, I want to talk to you, I want to hear from you about why you're engineering. I don't want to hear about, oh, I did really bad in the midterm, and can you fix this? That's not what I want to hear about, because to be frank, I actually don't have that power. I'll put that right out here right now, I do not have the power to adjust someone's grades. I do have the power, though, to take your ideas and move them forward. One of the reasons, I suspect a good reason that you're all here is that you know that we have these core programs, these core disciplines that you want, chem, right? Mech, which is just kind of spelled differently. Science, but then if you talk about the science, you can, you're here because you're the science. The reason you're here is you're the person, but you have all these binders and all these opportunities, all these certificates. Where do you think those came from? They came from these humans. You said you want to learn, understand more machine learning. You want to do robots, you want to do finance, you want to do game, you want to do music, you want to do technology, all this stuff. And you went and you talked about it. And you listened. The former dean, Christina Mon, is outstanding in building the foundation of the past 10 or 12 years, or 12, 15 years, of where we are now. Bringing those miners in, bringing those certificates in, getting engagement, getting your input to build those programs. If you look at the inside options, for instance, all those options, they morphed over the years. I mean, there's stuff that existed when I went through that's no longer there. They've changed. The nano option there, the nano option moves somewhere. So we're here to listen to your ideas. We're here to get your input about programs and opportunities. What can we do to change things up? When I went for undergrad, the idea, literally, of jumping on a plane and spending a term abroad was like, are you kidding? The idea of taking PY and disappearing for 12, 16 months was like, seriously? No, I don't want to get any here in 4 years. I don't want to spend any time. But that's all changed, right? It's all changed because of how the world's changed, the opportunities are presented, and the ways that we can help build those things. One of the things I did as ABP was bring in, $1.5 million of fellowships to help undergraduates and grad students go abroad, fully funded, for 10 to 12 weeks. And this is something I'm really passionate, really keen on facilitating you to do. As you can maybe pick up from now, the @UTNGD Twitter handle and Instagram handle. You should all, by the way, I want 1,000 followers. I'm an avid cypher. I brought this up actually. This is actually an analogy for somebody else who was bullying in their office, which is kind of entrepreneurship highways. But it's a good analogy here about the path that you want to take. Right? You're all on different paths. There's 1,100 different paths that you have to take. Anyone's a mountain biker, you know, there's probably 1,100 different routes to go down that route as well. There's no one defined route or station. There's lots of opportunities. Take those different trails. Take the one that's easy, maybe at one point take the one that's hard. It's all going to give you a chance to learn, to experience different things, and to gain a better understanding of what you're able to do, what you're really interested in doing, and how to move forward. I mentioned earlier, actually, you didn't see this, but like, I'm a runner, right? And I asked this question before, I'm trying to go over a marathon, and a group of kind of camp like this. And I use this analogy of a marathon is like undergrad. Right? It's basically 4 10Ks, a little bit at the end. And I said, don't start out too fast because it's a long way to go. And having run a marathon, I know that it kind of dies off again. But it's a learning opportunity. And I've run 36 marathons. Of those 36 marathons, they all be very different in experience. Right? Some have been extremely painful, extremely tiring. Others have worked out really well. Every single one has been different. Every single one has taught me something different about the fact that I didn't train well, I didn't eat well. Other times, it's just, the day was on. Everything worked. sense, because you don't get depth out of the bowl. There's no depth, but then you get insight, right? And so I challenge you to say, actually, pull away from your phones. Unless you're sitting in a fall right now. Pick up a book, read the newspaper, read it on bed, but read different sources so you get a holistic view of all what's going on in the world. I learned a ton over 2 years of flying around the world about geopolitics, and I frankly was like, this is like way wrong. But then I realized how it's all interconnected. What happens in China, what happens in Japan, what happens in Korea, what happens in England and the EU right now, directly obviously impacts us now. But understanding how we're all connected into that, the role engineering technology play nowadays, it's huge. Right? Just look at what's going on in trade right now. Okay? So it's really important to listen as well and to ask the deep questions. These are on Twitter, right? So they're my random handle. That's my personal handle, not my @GHD handle. But they know how many of these little surveys, right? I ask three questions and fire with your friends and ask them the same three questions. So I got this from a friend, and he said, okay, give me three things that you learned from, and then fire with your friends. So I'm going to kind of give you the three and give you the context. So the first one, so that's the first part of the CFO Tommy, teamwork, prioritization, comms, and how to work the problem. Engineering is all about working the problem, right? Come up with an optimal solution. It's all about custom design and working as teams, everything like that. What's interesting is that those experiences were during my first year of undergrad. My first summer job was not in a research lab. I was actually working for the Canadian Coast Guard doing intro rescue stuff. Three university students driving a boat up and down the St. Clair River, rescuing people, and literally acting as backup for the customs guys who were sitting there as well. They thought, this is cool. We've got these university students in Canadian Coast Guard, so it makes it look like they're law enforcement involved. But actually, they're not. They're kind of scared undergraduates driving a boat around. But it drives home to us that work together as a team when incidents happen, told us to be responsible. And responsible because we were doing a lot of stuff too. Speed control as well, right? I would respond, and that's what's interesting is I did speed control while I was in undergrad. Right? So you're taking the weekends and you're going out and you're just, I mean, it's exercise as well. That's the way I look at it. Okay, it's you around for free and hopefully no one hits a tree. But what's cool is I was actually learning speed control. Right? You think speed control, you think roll down your skiing and slopes and all that stuff. We were the first learning speed control team to actually win the regional first aid competition. For Southern Ontario. So they were like, how did you guys pull this off? Because the actual incident was on a downhill slope, and we made you cross country skiers go down a downhill slope to rescue somebody as a fake accident. They're like, well, we'll figure it out. There's a problem, but we got it. Okay, so that was the first one. The second one, play the long game. Right? It's not about the midterm, it's not about the problem set, which you do have to know about, but it's about how this is all preparing you for where you're going in the next 4, 5, 10, 15, 20. It's all about building that foundation. You've all built an outstanding, we know academically what your foundation, you even know all your other stuff because you're all brought these admissions. We know how that foundation has gotten you to where you are now. This is the next step. Building that foundation for you and your careers. Whether you're a researcher, whether you're going to start a company. I was at a demo day yesterday for the hatchery, getting a chance to see what the students had rolled together as ideas from an entrepreneurship perspective. Right? So it's working on me. The last one, okay, sort of, this will really gave me a make it seem kind of like a little bit goofy, but that was from when I was like 9 or 10. And that was when I was like in the Boy Scouts. Sorry, Boy Scouts, World Cups, that kind of stuff. But did God do your conservative? Did do your best? This was the credo of the job. Do your best, dogs do our best, and then do a good turn somewhere. It's a credo that I like to live by, right? I do my best for what I can, where I'm at, right? When I'm working out. I work together so that we do our best to move things forward, to help everybody out. And then the key is really, how do we do this for everyone else, right? As the engineers, we're helping to be global leaders, pushing for technology, solutions. When we think about the social impact of what we're doing as well. So it's always important to kind of keep that
keep that in mind.
Now, I wasn't supposed to, and I'm not going to do this long plenary lecture because there's no test in those afterwards. My ideal one was asked is to have Laura Berenega, the Genesis president, come up and basically do it like a little fireside chat. Unfortunately, she's unable to be here. So we volunteered another former student in this case, Professor Rayville, to ask this in a fireside chat mode, because it's a little more casual, it's a little more fun to do it that way. So you want to sit, you're on fire.
So yes, this is something made on the graduate here of BC, 97, and 99, and 2006. I don't want a jacket, but I never did get a jacket, but that would have been classic if we could both have been up here wearing our jacket. Yeah, proud alumnus of this institution, and yeah, happy to sort of step in. The questions that I'll throw at Dean Yip came from President Laura, I think in consultation of sort of thinking about what kinds of things might be on your mind. I have a couple of questions for her, but we've also been collecting some great questions from you as well, so I'll pull some of those questions. And then we have a couple of mics here, so we'll open it up for questions from the floor in a few minutes. But the first question I thought I want to ask from Laura's perspective is, you mentioned as a dean, you have certain powers and certain things you can and can't do. As you, what is it that sort of is in your core responsibilities? What can you do?
What can I do? So, I'm learning what I can do. So, as a dean, my role is to develop and the strategic vision for the faculty. Where it's going to go over the next 5 to 10 years, the ideas that you develop, and how do you take what is existing now and how do you tune things up? It's everything from deciding where you should make the best investments in our building. So the Micah Stickel, which you've all gone through, and you've seen the amazing building that actually is. That was a strategic plan by the former dean to pull people together to develop the next generation of teaching space, collaborative research space. My role is to work together with, I didn't even realize this, only 17 deans in the entire, all of the University of Toronto, and we run basically everything at that level. And part of my role is how do I interface with those other deans to work collaboratively, interdivisionally. You mentioned biomedical engineering, there's an exceptionally strong connection between engineering, dentistry, and medicine to drive those issues forward. So that's really my role. Is to do that, is to facilitate that, to engage with government, to engage with all the other deans around the world on building and moving the discipline forward.
So if you think back to your first year self, do you have any advice you would give now if you were back in the shoes of our incoming first year class?
The usual one is like, don't panic. It's a lot of fun going forward. It's intimidating. You're here. You've moved from your high school. There may only be a few people from your high school who are actually here. You may be the first person from your family or the only person who recognizes your nation's flag, etc. So my recommendation is actually not a work recommendation. It's a networking recommendation, right? You know, that look left, look right thing, sure, I changed it. Look left, look right, and this person made the idea of the school chart. I said, look left, look right behind you. Get everybody's email address, get everybody's phone number, and meet everyone for coffee. I'm not paying for that coffee, I'm paying for coffee. But I want you guys, I mean, seriously, you're all sitting, you're likely not sitting next to someone you know. And if you don't know them, get to know them, right, today. Say we're going to be the second cup, we're going to meet quality, we're going to do something. Just get to know people, right? And get to know people not just in engineering, outside of engineering as well. That's really
important. You know, when you think back to your undergraduate experiences, are there any particular experiences or activities that stood out for you that were really formative? Exciting, interesting?
So, how we gel in this meaningless space of 10 weeks, pull together a project. I remember we were all crashed in someone's house, my friend Michael's house. The teams there were all working this project, and I remember waking up next to, at that time, a dot matrix printer, which was still printing out our report, and looking over, and our entire team is fast asleep while this printer's printing the report. And that's when we realized, okay, we figured this all out. We got this together as a team, and we pulled together the report. And on time, even if they had a slide over to Professor Allen's report together.
Yeah. The team experiences are often one of the things you remember most significantly, and I absolutely go back to those as well, my second year and my capstone experience also. You know, Professor Bazylak posed the question around passion, and one of the students from the audience asked, what do you do if you're sort of feeling lost at the moment? You're not quite sure what your passion is. What recommendation, thoughts would you have for that?
In the precise moment, or overall? So,
now, or in the weeks, months, the
weeks, and months,
as those feelings come up, and they often
Yeah, so for me, one of the things, and we all go through this, we all have moments, I certainly have moments as faculty where you're like, why am I faculty member? I didn't get this grant. My student reviews for this course I thought were horrible.
Those that are also in the midst of this. great opportunity.
I think in terms of one of the things that was great is I spent, I don't know, I think it was like 10, 12 years in the admissions for ChemEng. And I was always impressed. And you were on the committee as well, and we moved this model to broadness, right? Mm-hmm. Looking at you as schools, it's not about the marks that you choose. Yes, it's one marker. It's all the other stuff you do. And I've always been super impressed by just the diversity of things that you are all doing outside of your academic careers. We've had Olympic athletes, we've had people who have discovered asteroids and comets, and people who've written books and written music and all that. Like, don't let engineering consume 150% of your time. Use that other time to do those other things, keep those other passions going, because that's really what's important.
All right, well, we have a few minutes left. You want to open the floor? There's a couple of mics there. So if anybody actually wants to just step up and come to the mic and ask a question, perhaps they didn't get answered yet, please just go ahead and here's your chance to just ask Dean of anything. There was a couple of great questions that came in. One of the questions was, do I have to go do my tutorial for ESP at 12? The answer is no. So there'll be no tutorials or practicals labs today or tomorrow. So just so you know, if you see that on your schedule, that's not something that you have to do. The key thing,
the ability to convey your ideas to a diverse audience, I think, is the key. everyone's really adept these days in social media. So how do you communicate a concept across social media on a character that's straightforward, right? We don't know what specifically we're interested in, but we have lots of different strategies with oral communication, communication, video, all that kind of stuff.
Hello. Throughout your travels, is there one skill or competence that you think makes you more effective in an international workplace?
Is there one skill or competence?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a great question.
That's an awesome question. I got to a really good question.
Fantastic.